Jordan, home to around 10 million people in the Middle East. Here, like in many other countries, the effects of climate change are starting to show. Scientists estimate that with a recorded decline of 1 meter per year, the Dead Sea could be dried out by 2050. The rate of global divestment from fossil fuel-driven industries and investment into renewable power generation will shape the future livelihood of our planet. Yet climate change is not the only reason why countries decide to invest into renewable power generation. As Jordan's expenses for the import of oil and gas started becoming a burden on the economy and Jordan experienced external shocks to the gas supply in 2011, the country decided to heavily invest into the diversification of its energy resources to increase the level of energy security. With its early investment in solar and wind, and its incentives to expand e-mobility, Jordan fast-tracked itself to become one of the leading countries in the implementation of renewables and its shift to sustainable power generation. Yet in the past 2 years, multiple challenges have slowed down the shift's momentum.
Jordan has gone a long way in renewable energy. Development started with the 2007 energy sector strategy, and with it, it was the first mention of renewable energy, and it specified even the share of renewable energy in the total energy mix. Now fast forward 13 years, now we have about 20% of our electricity coming from renewables.
So Jordan, within a few years, moved from zero utility scale renewable energy projects into more than 1,000 megawatts of projects. And as we stand today, there are in excess of $3 billion invested in renewable energy.
We also have 2,400 megawatts of projects either operating or under construction. Many laws and policies developed over the last 10 years in Jordan. It made Jordan a pioneering country in the MENA region for renewable energy, even worldwide. It was recognized by regional institutions as being the first country in per capita capacities of renewable energy.
But then in 2019, the Jordanian government decided to limit the new approvals of renewable energy to projects under 1 megawatt of capacity, which impacted the momentum of increased renewable energy share and the dynamics of the renewable energy market and opportunities available.
We have in Jordan around 1,400 companies working in the renewable energy field. Different scales of companies, small, medium, and large. Until we find a solution, the people and the companies working in this field faced bigger problems, like many people's lose their job.
Because of the limitation of the 1 mega cap that the government has enforced on the sector, we have interesting projects that's been delayed or moving very slow. One of them is a 10 megawatt or 12 megawatt solar projects for Queen Alia Airport with the AIG. We had at least not less than 100 mega in our, you know, pipeline to be executed. The majority of them were 20 mega and above.
يعني احنا كنا نشتغل مشاريع 2 ميجا 3 ميجا 5 ميجا حاليا فيش كله 1 ميجا فاحنا اضطرينا انه يقل الشغل وتقل المشاريع وادت الى تقليل العمال الايدي العامله فاحنا تركنا العمل وانا من الاشخاص اللي تركت العمل من وراء الموضوع هذا وتاذيت.
With many future renewable energy production plans being halted, investors could not go forward with investments in photovoltaic plants that exceeded the capacity of 1 megawatt, even though payback periods for an installation are relatively short.
We built this power plant, which is belong to Marriott and Sheraton Hotel. The capacity for this power plant is 6.3 megawatt and cover the need for these two hotels with clean energy, which produce around 25 megawatt every day.
If we took this power plant, you will see that the investor need not more than 5 years to get back their money. So the payback period is very interesting for the investor. So we don't need to lose this opportunity of investment.
The reasons for the plus 1 megawatt freeze are multifold, as the country is simultaneously dealing with technical issues in this shift, as well as economic reasons that influence decisions regarding the energy strategy.
Usually when you have integration of renewable energy, you also need to expand your grid. You need to make it more flexible. You need to basically also build interconnectors to neighboring countries to be able to import and export, just to have more space in the grid. And that didn't really happen. So we had a kind of overcapacity, like a surplus of electricity during peak times. And that's one reason why they have slowed down this whole generation of renewable electricity again.
The argument of the government or NEPCO or the Ministry of Energy is that having more renewable energy on the grid is not stabilizing the grid. It creates a lot of issues and problems for them on the grid. This argument, to a certain extent, is not valid because it's a technical issue, and technical issues open the door for investments for solution which can be solved.
From my point of view as an engineer, there is a many technical solution to solve this issue. But what I think there is a political decision behind, which is the government need to cover this demand from the imported gas.
Jordan never had its own resources, no oil, no gas. So traditionally, the whole market is based on importing gas and oil. That's why Jordan also has long-term agreements with energy companies outside of Jordan to import gas. And these agreements are, unfortunately, for a very long time with bound tariffs. So the energy provider here in Jordan, again, NEPCO, has to pay these companies to bring electricity to Jordan for the next 15 to 20 years. And it's very difficult to get out of these contracts or to get out of these agreements.
Late 2018, we at FES published a paper on the energy transition phase model for the MENA. Now, in this paper, we specify the phases that a country needs to go through to eventually reach a full and renewable energy transition. In it, we talked about Jordan. And we can see that Jordan now is in the second phase of the energy transition, which is focusing on grid extension and also adding flexibility measures.
The so-called freeze of all renewable energy projects above 1 megawatt capacity had different effects. While an emerging supply chain for utility and commercial projects was heavily affected by the new regulation, decentralized PV installations on a small scale flourished.
جاء هذا القرار نتيجة للمحددات الفنية للشبكة إضافة إلى الهدف من السماح لأكبر قدر ممكن من شركات الطاقة المتجددة للإفادة من الاستطاعات المتوفرة على الشبكة مع الأخذ بعين الاعتبار أن كافة الموافقات التي تم منحها قبل صدور هذا القرار تم استكمال العمل بهذه المشاريع بغض النظر عن مقدار الاستطاعة وإذا ما قارنا عدد الأنظمة التي تم تركيبها منذ بدء العمل على أنظمة الطاقة الشمسية حتى نهاية عام 2018 والبالغ 10,000 نظام تقريبا مقارنة مع عدد الأنظمة التي تم تركيبها خلال عامين تقريبا منذ بداية صدور القرار ببداية عام 2019 حتى شهر 11/2020 والبالغ 11,500 نظام وباستطاعة ما تقارب 280 ميجا فنلاحظ أن هذا الفرق في العدد يدل على استفادة عدد كبير من شركات الطاقة المتجددة من إقامة هذه المشاريع إضافة إلى استفادة عدد كبير من المستهلكين النهائيين من مشاريع الطاقة المتجددة.
So if you look at the rooftops of Jordanian homes today and you compare that to a satellite image of rooftops of Jordanian homes back in 2010, you would realize that there are so many homes, institutions, universities, hospitals that have PV panels on their rooftops for two reasons. One was that you get more efficient energy at cheaper rates. And two, you also turn the economy into a green economy because that also not only creates a source of power that is green and renewable, but it also creates a renewable energy sector.
While the installation of photovoltaic to power one's own home has direct benefits for the homeowner, opportunities to sell one's energy back to the state by hooking up one's panel to the grid are slim. First movers and large-scale projects who secured the access to feed their energy into the grid at an earlier point in time now take up the majority of the grid's capacity. Newcomers to decentralized power generation therefore may have their requests to feed into the grid rejected because of the technical limitations of the grid.
Each grid has a capacity for absorbing and taking renewable energy. In Jordan, the majority, more than 80%, went for the large consumers, for companies, for banks, for private schools and universities, and other large consumers. A small share of the market went for residential people and normal customers. 2020, 2019, we reached a point where there's now no capacity on the grid. The grid is saturated. Individuals are not able to connect, even sometimes 4 kilowatt gets rejected. The reason is the structure of electricity tariff and adopting net metering. Let's say we have different electricity tariff for residential customers with different levels. We have electricity tariff for street lighting, for water pumping, for banks, telecommunications, and factories. So this different electrical tariff between different stakeholders is one challenge for the photovoltaic market in Jordan. Why? Let's say a residential house will install a photovoltaic system and a commercial supermarket will install the same photovoltaic system. For the residential, each kilowatt hour produced will equal to what they actually buy from the grid, which is around, let's say, 50 fils. But for the commercial supermarket, the kilowatt hour produced is equal to about 180 fils. So that's why we see that the feasibility for the supermarket will maybe 2 years, but for the residential house will go up to 5 to 6 years. This is unjust and unfair because we are adopting net metering regulations.
اعتمدت استراتيجية قطاع الطاقة للعام 2020-2030 سيناريو الاعتماد على الذات، وذلك بهدف تنويع مصادر الطاقة وأشكالها، تخفيض كلفة الطاقة على الاقتصاد الوطني، تحسين كفاءة الطاقة في مختلف القطاعات، وتطوير منظومة قطاع الطاقة في الأردن ليصبح مركزاً إقليمياً لتبادل الطاقة بين الدول المجاورة، إضافة إلى زيادة مصادر الطاقة المحلية في خليط الطاقة الكلي. وتعتبر الطاقة المتجددة من أهم مصادر الطاقة المحلية التي سيتم العمل على تطويرها خلال السنوات القادمة، وذلك بهدف زيادة مساهمة الطاقة المتجددة في توليد الكهرباء من 13% بنهاية عام 2019 إلى 30% خلال عام 2030.
Similar to the head start in the implementation of photovoltaic, Jordan also took an international head start in encouraging citizens to buy and use e-mobility. At that time, Jordan led the discussion of e-mobility alongside countries like Norway. By exempting all e-vehicles from taxes and customs, in 2015, the government incentivized the purchase of e-vehicles with savings that could be as high as 8,000 JD or a rough equivalent of $11,000 per car.
جزء من مسؤولية الأردن تجاه مكافحة التغير المناخي كان باتخاذ عدد من الإجراءات التي من شأنها تخفيف التلوث البيئي الناتج عن قطاع النقل. قطاع النقل هو ثاني مصدر من مصادر التلوث البيئي في الأردن، وبالتالي قامت الحكومة انطلاقا من التزامها بالمعاهدات الدولية وانطلاقا من التزامها بالإجراءات المطلوب منها لمكافحة التغير المناخي بالتشجيع نحو النقل الكهربائي في الأردن من خلال تقديم عدد من الإعفاءات والاستثناءات الضريبية التي أدت بالنهاية إلى زيادة أعداد السيارات الكهربائية في الأردن وبالتالي تقليل الأثر البيئي لهذا القطاع.
Yeah, Jordan has been one of the very progressive countries when it comes to the import of electric vehicles and the development of an electric vehicle infrastructure between 2015 and 2019. How does that look like? Basically, they had an exemption of tax and customs, which makes a huge difference in Jordan because there's no production of cars in Jordan. They have to import every car anyway. So if you import a car and you don't have to pay tax and custom, the car could be up to 8,000 JD cheaper. That policy led to a very steep rise of electric vehicles in Jordan, which was definitely a pioneering action.
راح شو راح نتكلم بداية قصة النجاح بالنسبة لعدد السيارات بلشت في سنة 2015 حققنا الرقم 564 سيارة مرخصة بال 2016 صار هنالك كمان نمو 1274 سيارة مرخصة بال 2017 صار هنالك نمو عن سنة مقارنة مع سنة 2016 أربع أضعاف أو خمس أضعاف الرقم يعني وصل لغاية 7755 سيارة بال 2019 تقريبا بلغ المجموع أعداد السيارات المجموع الرقم التراكمي من 2015 لغاية 2019 اللي مرخصة 21182 سيارة مرخصة.
Then, January 2019, the Jordanian government decided to increase tax and customs on sales of e-vehicles again. This decision immediately affected the demand on e-vehicles in the coming months and led to a steep decline of sales.
أحد أهم التحديات التي واجهت الوزارة في التوجه نحو النقل الكهربائي هي الأوضاع الاقتصادية التي عصفت بالأردن خلال العشر سنوات الأخيرة. وهذا كان حقيقة من ضمن الأسباب الرئيسية التي جعلت الحكومة تتراجع قليلاً عن الاستثناءات المقدمة للسيارات الكهربائية.
In May, the number of electric vehicles import dropped to 70%. Out of the sudden, nobody bought electric vehicles anymore.
2017, I actually started my own business that sells electric vehicles. It was called EV King. It was the first business in Jordan that only sells electric vehicles exclusively. But with the removal of the exception on taxes on electric vehicles, we no longer can sell many cars each month.
I can only speculate about the reasons, but one reason could definitely be that the state needs revenue very urgently, and people that are buying cars and not paying import tax or custom duties are then obviously not contributing to the state revenue. The second reason could also be because benzene in Jordan has tax, so people that are charging their normal cars are contributing to the state revenue, while the electricity is being subsidized. So again, in terms of finance for the budget, it's always better to have people paying the petrol instead of electricity.
While citizens interested in investing in e-vehicles face an increased sales price, owners of electric vehicles struggle with a lack of infrastructure and have difficulties finding public charging stations that offer convenient waiting times.
We have a big problem here in Jordan when it comes to public charging infrastructure. We only have 18 DC fast charging stations in Jordan, and we have more than 20,000 cars in Jordan. So these public charging stations become very congested. It's not surprising to see maybe 8, 10 or 12 cars waiting in line to use the charging station.
I want to charge, so in this gas station that has a supercharger. Only a couple of gas stations has these in Amman. And because of that, there will be a congestion on the number of cars that charging, especially at the time when people leaving work, at 5 p.m. So I have four cars in front of me. Each car would take around 20 minutes to charge.
People are not having that patience. People that work can't wait for an hour, 2 hours to charge. So either they charge at home, but that's also expensive to install a charging point, or they decide to use their other car, to use the dirty car. And that's a very sad conclusion.
Having more tax on these electrical vehicles will prevent this market from developing and growing in Jordan. I think it's very important to remove the tax from the electrical vehicles and let people use more and buy more electrical vehicles.
We recommend to buy electric buses, not only electric cars. This has like several reasons. First of all, it's still much more climate friendly and has much less CO2 emissions than electric cars, of course. Second, and that's a special case in Jordan, electric buses have huge batteries. These huge batteries can be used to take the pressure off the electricity grid. So basically, we have a solution for two problems here, the grid congestion problem and the transport problem. Our second recommendation is building up the charging infrastructure. Building up a charging infrastructure would really help every owner of an electric vehicle and would also give an incentive to again buy more electric vehicles and to increase that number again. Our third recommendation would be to maybe open the market for small vehicles. This could be e-scooters or e-bikes or any other kind of small vehicle with like an electric kind of engine. Because small vehicles have so much less CO2 emissions than big ones, and every SUV that's having that's run by electricity is still much more inefficient than a small vehicle that's run by petrol or like benzene. And hence, small vehicles would always be a good solution for a climate-friendly transport policy and in order to save CO2 emissions.
تضمنت استراتيجية قطاع الطاقة للعام 2020-2030 عدد من البرامج والمشاريع لتشجيع التحول نحو استخدام وسائل النقل الكهربائية. طبعا العمل على هذه المشاريع هو مسؤولية مشتركة بين جهات متعددة منها وزارة النقل، وزارة البيئة وجهات أخرى سيتم العمل معها لتنفيذ هذه المشاريع، وذلك بهدف وضع عدد من الآليات لتحفيز المواطنين للتحول نحو وسائل النقل الكهربائية، إضافة إلى العمل لتحويل أسطول النقل العام إلى وسائل النقل الكهربائية، استبدال وسائل والحافلات القديمة في أسطول النقل العام إلى حافلات كهربائية، والأهم من ذلك العمل على وضع البنية التحتية وتوفير البنية التحتية لتشجيع المواطنين للتحول نحو وسائل النقل الكهربائية.
We can see the rest of the renewable energy story in Jordan in the new energy strategy, which spans for the period 2020-2030. We can see a clear change in the implementation. There will be a slower pace for new renewable energy projects. On the other hand, there will be more measures for grid connectivity and also flexibility, which will open the door for more renewable energy in the future. But we always need to keep that in mind, that renewable energy is the target that we need to work for.
Understanding the obstacles that appear in the light of such a rapid transition to renewable energy renders Jordan a learning case, as recommended solutions for shared challenges may be transferred to other countries shifting to renewable power generation.